Figuring.
Explore that part, all of you. What is lower return? I mean, I've heard some people say we want a minimum of 30%. 30% is the new normal. Where on earth does that come from?
Yeah.
What about 8%?
So, Rohini, let me answer that question the opposite way. So my partner Praveen Gandhi and I sat down and said, okay, let's look deeply at microfinance companies. So we met a slew of them. And each of them convinced us that the only way to survive is the microfinance companies to charge 36% interest from poor people. Right?
Well,
and we said,
24, yeah.
Nobody makes it at 24, right? Your cost of funds is 13%, your cost of managing it is 8-9%. You know, SKS is at 27 and so on and so forth.
Right.
So when you know that you're charging 24% when a bank charges, you know, one third as much, you know that there's some, you know, you need to get the finances right in that sector. From an investor's point of view, it's really, I think most, see, look at the LPs who invest in investors such as us. They have debt where they can get it 2, 3, 4%. They want to add some spice to the portfolio, so they do early stage. And their expectations of early stage are 20 to 25% IRR. I don't think anybody is going out there looking for 30% IRR. Only the Indian stock market and Rashesh can give you that, right? And not early stage. I don't think early stage necessarily gives you that. And, you know, PE and other stuff gives you 10 to 15%, you know, 7 to 10% IRR. So I'm not so sure that 30% is a new 8%. I don't see that.
I think I just have another point to add. Again, it is the same question you're asking, Rohini, is what is adequate returns? Because even I think we all, you know, are convinced that the MFIs have been exploitative and make an excess return and charging 30-30. But if you look at the return on equity, ROEs of all these firms, they are like any other NBFC. They are like maybe any other good quality bank. So I think who decides what is good or bad? And the fact is, by making those kind of ROEs, if you're able to scale up and serve, you know, 30 million customers, is that always bad? And I think that is where the problem between social and commercial. And I think at a startup stage, at the early stage, everybody is more social than commercial. But the moment you want to scale up, the moment you want to start, you know, reinvesting back the money and go for returns, the commercialization starts to come in. And I think making that change, and hence, because investors want you to scale up and, you know, make returns and become self-sustainable. And when you start up, you are a social enterprise. So that mix that happens between starting off as social and then becoming more and more commercial and making the trade-offs in that is where, again, the confusion is always there.
I have just a slight difference of opinion from this because specifically on the MFI part, because we have been discussing that, I think if you look at all the MFIs, when you say that they started social and they became more and more commercial going ahead, I don't think maybe completely correct because the rates that MFIs have been charging have been generally coming down as they have become more and more bigger. As the scale improved, they have been actually, and actually even more investors also come in. The fact that they have to continue to get scale and continue to become more profitable and therefore get more customers will drive them to be more friendly to your customer. So you will have to go down on the reverse direction. And if you also look at the margin that has been specified, 10-12%, that also includes that you have to get into your operation expenses as well. The reason that they might get high equity is because of the leverages that have been possible in the sector so long, which therefore enable them to get the ROE. But the other way of looking at it is, yes, 33% or 26%, which there are real reasons why companies operating in that space have to get into that. But for the guy on the ground, the alternative is 60% per month or 10% per month. And for him, it is a cash flow issue. The whole structure is modeled based on money and all that.
I understand the justification, but when you come across and say somebody is doing 36%, it's insane. Let me throw another question back. I mean, by most people in the house would not consider Facebook or Google as social investments. But guess what? Facebook and Google brought down governments in Egypt, Tunisia, are bringing down governments in Libya. Which NGO has done that? Right? So are they hence social enterprises or not social enterprises? I think it's probably simplistic to say only early stage is social. I think at that scale, when you're having information and community available to everybody, obviously the Facebook was not set up to bring down authoritarian governments, but it's doing that. So, you know, I think there is a sense of social return you get.
Google and Facebook, but let's take it away from that because we have been asked to find out about this missing impact investor. Now, do you think things like social stock exchanges, will that bring more impact investors together? Is that a floatable idea?
He's the master.
No, as I said, I think earlier, we need Yeah, I think it's already a slightly, you know, armor first confused kind of an approach. It will evolve. I think this segment will evolve because there will be social enterprise that will emerge. We're still at a very early stage for investors to understand the trade-off between commercial returns and the social ones. But I think having intermediation mechanisms, including maybe a stock exchange, I think one of the ideas that I've been very enamored with is this whole concept of, you know, social credits, like you have carbon credit. So like, you know, in the commercial banking segment, I think we have RBI saying you should open bank branches in, you know, tier 5, tier 6 cities, which is not financially as viable where everybody wants to open in urban. If you can create what has been created for carbon credit, equivalent of that, social, so like, you know, you start off your business, create jobs, cater to the bottom of the pyramid, harder to be very commercially viable in the early days, maybe because you're investing back, but you earn social credit with some, you know, FMCG company which wants to increase, you know, and they can easily buy that, the way it has been done for carbon credit. So we can use stock exchange, the market mechanisms and all of that to make this easier for capital to flow without making this compromise between commercial objectives and social objectives.
If I can add on to that.
Does it sound like a Pandora's box for anyone?
No, I think it's a lovely idea. Social credits, I think it's a lovely idea.
Rating agencies and other things will have to follow. Who will be the arbiter of the value of that social credit?
The market will, right?
It's like carbon credit. I think the market will decide.
I think if I can just take a step back from that point, you know, why I brought up the issue of the time duration and large amount of funding. The sectors, you know, my understanding, is that the sectors which have the ability to have the scale and create commercial returns for VCs in India would be sectors which would need large amounts of capex.
Not necessarily so. I mean, if that was so, then Sasha and I wouldn't be in business at all, or neither would he. I really don't think so. We've done exits. We've made exits. I think you're being extraordinarily general, but that's not really true in the.
No, I'm not sort of trying to say that all of them. But take agribusiness for example. Mm-hmm. If you were to set up any kind of venture which has scale, which looks at creating a supply chain which will have tens of thousands of farmers in its network, and then process a product and package it and sell it in the market, that is going to need some amount of capex. And these things are not where you can, you know, bootstrap and start in a small way. You will still need an initial amount of capex. So that becomes a challenge sort of in the current context. So my point to, you know, instead of an exchange, an alternative exchange like a social exchange or something, it would be great. But more importantly, if the equity investor community and, for example, in this forum, what is the representation of the debt investors, the banks? Where are they? I don't think there are very many. We need to have a sort of a way of bringing them into this fold. And if equity investors who have to have higher returns and invest in business like, which need large amounts of capex, and the government has very clearly said there are clear norms about priority lending and things like that, but on the ground it just doesn't translate. Right. If we could facilitate that bit itself, it will just help
so
tremendously.
So that's one kind of thing that government can do. Is there anything else in the ecosystem that needs to be done from public policy perspective to enhance this space?
No, I think just to come in there, I think there is already the ecosystem in terms of policy initiatives is that much more more up there as it was some time back. But I think at least the way we are thinking at it is that social investment is, we believe, is no longer seen as social in that sense, because it is much more, if I can borrow the word, mainstream, although we tend to believe these things are not right ways of using it. But we believe now the work that Sri Kumar is doing in terms of backending integration, et cetera, is real business. I mean, there is no need to call it as a social business, because you are very mainstream in terms of procuring supplies from the back end and supplying it to the front. I think in that sense, the policy initiative in terms of the ecosystem developing, in terms of retailing, in terms of front end marketing, in terms of branding, et cetera, the whole system has evolved to a stage where these things have become something that every enterprise will have to get into at some stage. And therefore, there is some of them are moving back, some of them are moving friends, somebody is somewhere in the middle. So I think from that perspective, what we have seen overall, the rise of the consumer class, the rise of the more demand, quality consciousness, aspirations increasing, et cetera, has all contributed to the rise that entrepreneurs are sensing this opportunity and they want to go in there and try to see how big they can become in this current environment.
Okay, we should throw it to the audience, but if anyone wants to, I want to ask you, finally, what made you sell your story? What is it that the investors need to know to build the confidence that, yes, I can take this risk, this early stage risk?
Yeah, okay. Well, I think my learning has been that to get traction into funding and attract a VC to get into, you know, funding an early stage startup business essentially and a large needing a large amount of capital has been to first get a large you know, number of angels involved, which is where, you know, I had to, you know, go to angel investors in the UK and from India, various parts of India, including, you know, Sasha's Mumbai Angels, where, you know, two of them invested. So that getting, you know, I have to share with you, you know, double digit number of angel investors. So to get that traction was extremely difficult, but that was the starting point. With having gotten them on board, then the VCs got interested. Then, you know, the bank could see the, you know, that it was absolutely viable to do that with all of this, which kind of takes me back to the point of and which has been mentioned here, that because of this, the current state in the angel investment community, which is not sort of highly developed, that is the challenge. And I think if you know, a startup needing large amount of capital, if one can be able to access a significant amount of angel funding initially, it will certainly make the traction easier.
Can I just add, I think, as I was thinking about this, you know, the curious case of the missing impact investor, I think ultimately this will have to be solved by the entrepreneurs. It won't be solved by the investors themselves. I think the entrepreneurs will have to solve this particular case.
So they have to make the business case better?
So I think, yeah, I think they have to make the business case better by making it easier, removing complexity from understanding. I think I'm happy that you are clear. It's a commercial business. This is what I'm doing. This is how we're going to. So I think remove complexity between commercial and social. I think go out and search for investors. I think one of the key elements, qualification criteria for being an entrepreneur is an ability to raise capital, whether you are a commercial entrepreneur or a social entrepreneur. I think one of the key qualifying criteria is you have to be able to raise capital again and again as you want to scale up. So I think go out and basically get the investors, whether they are commercial or impact investors, whatever they are. I think the entrepreneurs will have to make the effort. I don't think investors on their own are going to say, okay, I'm going to now become an impact investor and understand all this. So I think make it easy, make it simple, understand the needs of the investor. And I think as long as you have a good story, either on the commercial side or the social side, or even as an NGO, I think investors are always out there. At least the hypothesis has to be that the investors are there.
So let me add something, Rohini. I mean, I think Sasha will also agree that we've kind of calculated that typically of all the startups that we see, one out of 200 or one out of 300 gets funded. So we have to see 2 to 300 before one gets funded. So I know you're saying it's difficult. I'm saying, you know, you're the lucky sperm. The other 100 million didn't make it. So I think so my flip story is it's not really so much the case of the missing impact investor. It's probably, if anything, the case of the missing impact investee. Are you able to make that impact on us for us to be able to invest in you? Because we're here. The funds are here, the money is here, the ability is here. But you've got to really understand that you can't come with a
capacity building needed at a very large level. I mean,
yeah, so you need to understand our needs.
There's no impact investor, but surely there are impact investors.
Yeah.
I'll give you an example, a very small example. So in my private hat, which is non-profit, which is Mumbai Angels, which is just me and a bunch of other friends of mine who invest together, we've done mostly commercial investments as well because, you know, we want to make money. But recently, you know, we made some good exits and we said we should do something. And I was reading Mint and I saw this article about this interesting company. Then I just said, you know, this guy is doing some fantastic stuff. And I, in my mind, kept saying, I'm relatively young. I'll do social impact investing when I make money because I'm very poor. And